Random House Audio presents The Double Bind by Chris Bohjalian, read for you by Susan Denaker. Laurel Estabrook was nearly raped the fall of her sophomore year of college. Quite likely, she was nearly murdered that autumn. This was no date rape disaster, with a handsome, entitled UVM frat boy after the two of them had spent too much time flirting beside the bulbous steel of a beer keg. This was one of those violent, sinister attacks involving masked men, yes, men plural, and they actually were wearing wool ski masks that shielded all but their eyes and the snarling rifts of their mouths, that one presumes only happens to other women in distant states. To victims whose faces appear on the morning news programs and whose devastated, forever wrecked mothers are interviewed by strikingly beautiful anchor women. She was biking on a wooded dirt road 20 miles northeast of the college in a town with a name that was both ominous and oxymoronic, Underhill. In all fairness, the girl did not find the name Underhill menacing before she was assaulted. But she also did not return there for any reason in the years after the attack. It was somewhere around 6:30 on a Sunday evening, and this was the third Sunday in a row that she had packed her well-traveled mountain bike into the back of her roommate Talia's station wagon and driven to Underhill to ride for miles and miles along the logging roads that snaked through the nearby forest. At the time, it struck her as beautiful country, a fairy tale wood more Lewis than Grimm, the maples not yet the color of claret. It was all new growth, a third-generation tangle of maple and oak and ash, the remnants of stone walls still visible in the understory not far from the paths. It was nothing like the Long Island suburbs where she had grown up, a world of expensive homes with manicured lawns only blocks from a long neon-lit swath of fast-food restaurants, foreign car dealers, and weight loss clinics in strip malls. After the attack, of course, her memories of that patch of Vermont woods were transformed, just as the name of the nearby town gained a different, darker resonance. Later, when she recalled those roads and hills, some seeming too steep to bike, but bike them she did, she would think instead of the washboard ruts that had jangled her body and her overriding sense that the great canopy of leaves from the trees shielded too much of the view and made the woods too thick to be pretty. Sometimes, even many years later, when she would be trying to fight her way to sleep through the flurries of wakefulness, she would see those woods after the leaves had fallen and visualize only the long finger grips of the skeletal birches. By 6:30 that evening, the sun had just about set and the air was growing moist and chilly. But she wasn't worried about the dark because she had parked her friend's wagon in a gravel pull-off beside a paved road that was no more than 3 miles distant. She would be there in 10 or 15 minutes, and as she rode, she was aware of the thick-lipped whistle of the breeze in the trees. She was wearing a pair of black bike shorts and a jersey with an image of a yellow tequila bottle that looked phosphorescent printed on the front. She didn't feel especially vulnerable. She felt, if anything, lithe and athletic and strong. She was 19. Then a brown van passed her. Not a minivan, a real van. The sort of van that, when harmless, is filled with plumbing and electrical supplies, and when not harmless, is packed with the deviant accoutrements of serial rapists and violent killers. Its only windows were small portholes high above the rear tires, and she had noticed, as it passed, that the window on the passenger side had been curtained off with black fabric. When the van stopped with a sudden squeal 40 yards ahead of her, she knew enough to be scared. How could she not? She had grown up on Long Island, once a dinosaur swampland at the edge of a towering range of mountains, now a giant sandbar in the shape of a salmon, the almost preternaturally strange petri dish that spawned Joel Rifkin, serial killer of 17 women. Colin Ferguson, the LIRR slaughter. Cheryl Pearson, arranged to have her high school classmate murder her father. Richard Angelo, Good Samaritan Hospital's angel of death. Robert Golub, mutilated a 13-year-old neighbor. George Wilson, shot Jay Gatsby as he floated aimlessly in his swimming pool. John Esposito, imprisoned a 10-year-old girl in his dungeon. And Ronald DeFeo, slaughtered his family in Amityville. In truth, even if she hadn't grown up in West Egg, she would have known enough to be scared when the van stopped on the lonely road directly before her. Any young woman would have felt the hairs rise up on the back of her neck. Unfortunately, the van had come to a stop so abruptly that she couldn't turn around because the road was narrow and she used a clipless pedal system when she rode. This meant that she was linked by a metal cleat in the sole of each cycling shoe to her pedals. She would have needed to snap her feet free, stop, and put a toe down to pivot as she swiveled her bike 180 degrees. And before she could do any of that, two men jumped out, one from the driver's side and one from the passenger's, and they both had those intimidating masks shielding their faces. A very bad sign indeed in late September, even in the faux tundra of northern Vermont. And so, with a desperate burst of adrenaline, she tried to pedal past them. She hadn't a prayer. One of them grabbed her around her shoulders as she tried to race by, while the other was hoisting her and her bicycle off the ground by her waist. They were, essentially, tackling her as if she were a running back and they were a pair of defensive linemen who had reached her in the backfield. She screamed, shrill, girlish, desperate screams that conveyed both her vulnerability and her youth. At the same time that a part of her mind focused analytically on what might have been the most salient feature of her predicament, she was still locked by her shoes to her bike, and she had to remain that way at all costs while holding on fast to the handlebars. This alone might keep her off the sides of Vermont milk cartons and the front pages of the Vermont newspapers. Why? Because she realized that she couldn't possibly overpower her assailants. Even her hair was lanky and thin. But if they couldn't pry her from the bicycle, it would be that much more difficult to cart her into the deep woods or throw her into the back of their van. At one point, the more muscular of the two, a thug who smelled like a gym, not malodorous, not sweaty, but metallic like weights, tried to punch her in the face, but she must have ducked because he slammed his fist into the edge of her helmet and swore. His eyes beneath his mask were the icy gray of the sky in November, and around each wrist she saw a coil of barbed wire had been tattooed like a bracelet. He yelled for his partner, who had a tattoo as well, a skull with improbable ears, sharp ears, a wolf's, and long wisps of smoke snaking up from between the fangs in its mouth, to put the goddamn bike down so he could rip her foot from the cleat. She kept her foot pointing straight ahead. The metal clip in the sole snapped tightly into the pedal. He tried yanking at her ankle, but he knew nothing about cleats, and so he wasn't precisely sure how to twist her foot. Meanwhile, they called her a cunt. In the space of moments, not minutes, but maybe, they called her a cunt, a twat, a pussy, a gash, a fucking cunt, a stupid cunt, a teasing cunt, fish cunt, slut cunt, you dead cunt. No verb. Even the words were violent, though initially three sounded to her less about the hate and the anger and the derision. Those words were spoken, not shouted, with a leer by the thinner of the pair. An inside joke between the two of them, and it was only after he had repeated them did she understand it was not three words she was hearing, but two. It was a made-up brand name, a noun, a flavor at her expense. He had reduced her vagina to an aperitif on the mistaken assumption that there could possibly be even a trace of pre-coital wetness lubricating her now. Liqueur snatch. That was the joke. Get it? Get it? not lick her snatch. A French cordial instead. But the joke elicited nothing from his partner, no reaction at all, because this was only about his...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.